Morning
to all. So we have successfully completed one more topic, that is the cell and its organelles, or cell and its components, where we have studied the details of the cell, starting from the plasma membrane to the nucleolus and even to the chromatin fibers and the ultrastructure of the chromatin fiber in the nucleosomes. So after having studied all these things, now I think is the time to move on to the next chapter, that is the chromosomes. So this chromosome, actually it's a 5 hours topic, but the syllabus they have given is only sufficient for 2 or 3 hours, because types of chromosome, fine structure, again we have to discuss what we have discussed in the last class, then heterochromatin, euchromatin, and the polytene chromosome. Though it's 5 hours chapter, the syllabus is only what we can discuss is only for 3 hours. Okay. We took one more extra hour while discussing this cell and its components. So there is nothing to worry as far as the time factor is concerned. Now today we will start with the chromosomes. Probably one of the most interesting component in the cell, the chromosomes, and the most talked about subject in biology is also nowadays the chromosomes and the associations, functions that are carried by the chromosomes. So now first let's try to understand what exactly meant by chromosome, how it is there, and its morphology. Then we can move on to the remaining aspects of that. What are these chromosomes? The literary meaning, which all of you know, chroma means color, soma means body. The literary meaning, if you ask someone, if someone asks you what is chromosome, you can say that it is the colored body. Now the question comes, why is called so? For this very simple reason, these chromosomes stain with dark colors and distinctly they are seen with the stain that they imbibe or take. That's why they are called as chromosomes, colored bodies. But for the students of undergraduate course, if someone asks chromosome, if you say colored bodies, I don't think it is the right definition of what a biologist wants can give. So that's why we will try to understand in detail about this chromosome. What are chromosomes? They are the packaging for our genes. This is a packet. Chromosome is a packet in which you can see the genes. And being the students of biology, you know, genes are responsible for each and everything. If you are tall, it's because of your genes. If you are short, it's also because of genes. If you are fat, again, credit goes to genes. If you are dark, credit goes to genes. If you have a black eye, again, genes. If you have a cat eye, again, it is because of genes. If you have straight hair, genes are responsible. If you have curly hair, again, the genes are responsible. So that means for everything an organism is formed, starting from shape, size, complexion, to the normal functioning or abnormal functioning. Everything, for everything, the genes are responsible. So now you have understood the importance of the gene. So remember, these genes are nicely packed, perfectly packed in this chromosome. So that's why chromosomes are nothing but packaging for our genes. Genes, as I have told you, these are the instructions. Genes is a software. It's a software. Based on the software, the hardware functions. In fact, hardware itself is created based on the instruction given by the software. If you compare the genes to the software, you can say that whatever the body that we have, it is nothing but the hardware. So, the genes are the instructions that have been used to make the functional product. Again, functional product means proteins. All of you know the proteins are the building blocks. What type of protein? What kind of protein? What proportion of proteins? All those things are decided by the genes. And as per the instruction that has been given by the genes, these functional products, the proteins are formed, which are the building blocks. Basic component, again, building blocks are they are the basic component of all living cells. So, the chromosomes pack those genes. Now, where these chromosomes are formed? The chromosomes are found in every cell of our body, especially if you take the mammals, except in RBC of mammals. Because in RBC of mammalian blood, there is no nucleus and there is no chromosome. Except these red blood corpuscles, everywhere you can expect, in every cell of the body, you can expect the presence of these chromosomes. Now, what exactly is a chromosome? Chromosomes are rod-shaped filamentous body. They are like, actually, instead of rod-shaped or capsule-shaped, we can say most of the time. They are rod-shaped filamentous bodies, which are present in the nucleus. Though they are present in the nucleus, the chromosomes are visible only when the nucleus dissolves. That's the another very interesting thing. When the nucleus is visible in a cell, you will not be able to see the chromosomes. What you can see is the chromatin fibers. But when the nucleus dissolves, it is during the cell division, either mitosis or meiosis. When the nucleus dissolves or disintegrates, then the chromosomes become visible in the shape of a rod or a capsule. Otherwise, in an interface cell, when the cell is in a non-dividing state, when the nucleus is distinct, you will not be able to see the chromosome. But still they are formed in the form of a long thread, what is known as chromatin fiber. If you recollect what happens during the cell division, in the first stage of the cell division, that is the prophase, the nuclear membrane dissolves or disintegrates. As a result, cytoplasm mixes with the nucleoplasm. Now there is no identity, separate identity for the nucleus. During this time, the same chromatin fiber condenses and becomes rod-shaped structure, what we call it as chromosomes. These chromosomes are the carrier of the genes. As I already told you, the genes are nicely packed. Or as a result, the chromosomes become the unit of heredity. They become the unit of heredity. Now, The chromosomes are not visible in active nucleus. Why? Because of two things. One is chromosome form will not be there, but it is in the form of chromatin fiber. Then, along with that, nucleoplasm has high water content. In the high water content, even the chromatin fibers are not visible under the normal microscope. But during the cell division, they become more apparent and very clear. These chromosomes were first discovered by Strasburger in 1875. Almost 150 years back. Though the Strasburger first observed and described the chromosome, the term chromosome was given by Waldeyer in 1888, 13 years after the Strasburger's discovery. So, term chromosome was coined by Waldeyer in 1888. They were given the name chromosome because chromo means color, soma means body, due to their marked affinity for basic dyes. These chromosomes have affinity for basic dyes because the chromosomes contain nucleic acid. And this nucleic, any acidic one has a affinity for basic dyes. If it is basic, it will have affinity for acidic dyes. So here, they have affinity for basic dyes as they contain the nucleic acid. So you can count, see, observe, verify the chromosome only during the cell division. That too in the mitotic metaphase. Metaphase stage in the cell division is the most ideal state to study the chromosome, because at this stage the chromosome becomes very short and thick and more condensed. All of you know now, chromosomes are made out of thin chromatin threads, or which are popularly called as chromatin fibers. Chromatin fibers, they wind, coil, supercoil, twist, rewind, and they are represented in the form of a small rod-shaped structure, what is known as chromosomes. That is, they undergo folding, coiling, supercoiling in the prophase state or prophase stage of the mitosis, so that chromosomes becomes progressively thicker and smaller and shorter also. Because of folding, coiling, supercoiling, and all those things. What is the result? The result is we will be able to observe the chromosome under the light microscope. We are able to observe the chromosome even with the help of the light microscope. But at the end of the cell division, same process repeats, in the sense the fibers, chromosomes start uncoiling, unfolding. As a result, the chromosome is extended as a fine chromatin thread. Once they become fine chromatin threads, they are not visible with the help of light. Only when they become short, thick and short, then only they are visible with light microscope. Now, each species has a definite number of chromosomes. And two species can have same number of chromosomes. But if you take one species, in all the members of that species, the chromosome number is same. For example, in case of the human beings, we have 46 chromosomes or 23 pairs. You take the human being, either Afro-American, Indian, or he can be Chinese, African, European, even Eskimos. If he is a human being, if you name an individual as human being, invariably he will have 46 chromosomes. 46 number of chromosomes. So chromosome is number is same. Whereas chimpanzees have 48, dogs have 78, horse 64, chicken 78. And the very less number of chromosomes you can see in the roundworms. Only two chromosomes. In roundworms, you will see only two chromosomes. Even if you come to plants, onion has 16. Even fungus mold, it's also having 16. I have told you, two species can have the same number of chromosomes. And for example, carrot is also having 20 chromosomes. Mage is also having 20 chromosomes. Tomato and rice, both of them are having 24 chromosomes. On the extreme, roundworms show only two chromosomes. On the extreme higher side, if you look, some protozoans are having 300 or more chromosomes. So by this, one is very clear. You do not see any correlation between size of the organism and the number of chromosomes. Protozoans being microscopic, they will have more than 300 plus chromosomes. Roundworms, which are visible with our naked eye, they have only two chromosomes. There is no correlation between the chromosome number and the body size. But one thing, if you want to draw some commonality among this, most of the organisms have the chromosome number between 12 to 15. Chromosome numbers are most common among the most of the organisms. If you take 3 to 8 is common among the fungi. 8 to 16 in angiosperms. 12 is the most common number. Many plants have 12 chromosomes. Chromosome size then. Number, of course, it varies from species to species, but within a species, the number is same. Same number can be shared by 2-3 species also, or more than many species. That's all. All these things are there as far as the chromosome numbers are concerned. Now, coming to the chromosome size, even the size of the chromosome shows remarkable variation. One is depending upon the stage of the cell division. In cell division, you have different stages: prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. In each phase or stage of the mitosis, the size of the chromosome varies. If you take the interphase, the non-dividing phase, chromosomes are longest and thinnest. And in fact, we don't call it as chromosome, it is the chromatin fiber then. Once the cell enters into prophase, there's a progressive decrease in size, length. Prophase, chromosomes start unwinding, coiling, supercoiling chromatin fibers, and they become little thick and visible under the light microscope also. But the next stage, the anaphase stage, chromosomes are smallest, very short, thick. But in metaphase stage, the chromosomes can be easily observed. Why we can study the chromosome in the metaphase means, in the metaphase they are thick, short. Of course, the visibility will be very clear. More than that, they are well spread in the cell. They are well spread in the cell. So that's why in metaphase you can easily study the chromosome. Probably that's the reason when you want to measure the length of the chromosome, metaphase, meiotic metaphase in the ideal stage. So whatever the length we have mentioned here, that is the size, as far as the size of the chromosome is concerned, it is taken at the mitotic metaphase. The size of the chromosome in this mitotic stage, metaphase stage of the mitosis varies between 0.5 microns to 32 microns in length. 0.5 millimicrons to 32 microns in length. And diameter is about 0.2 and 3 millimicrons in diameter. That's a variation, depending upon the species. In some it may be long. Longest metaphase chromosome is found in Trillium, a plant, which is 32 millimicrons. As an exception, some insects found in the Diptera group of insects, you can see some giant chromosome, where they may measure up to 300 millimicrons and up to 10 millimicrons in diameter. So that's why they are called as giant chromosomes. That's also especially in the larva of the salivary gland, like Drosophila, or even mostly in larva of Drosophila and Diptera members, they have some giant chromosome. They are exceptional. Otherwise, generally it is in between 0.5 to 30 millimicrons in length. If you want to generalize the chromosome size, plants have longer chromosome than animals. Compared to animals, when you make it generalized, plants have longer chromosome than animals. And one more thing, the species which are having lower chromosome, they have longer chromosomes. Lower the chromosome number, longer will be their size. That means the roundworms which are having only two chromosomes, they have long chromosomes. Generally, the cells which are having more number of chromosomes, they have short size chromosomes. If they have less number of chromosomes, the size of the chromosome will be more. Among plants, dicots have higher number of chromosomes than monocots. So as dicots have higher number of chromosomes, the size of the chromosome is short compared to monocots. Then, about the chromosomal structures. If you unwind a chromosome, it will end up in a single long molecule of DNA. which has been combined with the proteins. That means each chromosome is a long thread of DNA along with protein. This is chemical structure. Chemically, what are the chromosomes? That is nothing but the nucleic acid, which is the deoxyribonucleic acid plus proteins. The metaphase chromosome is double in construction. Metaphase chromosomes will show everything double, because that's a duplicated molecule. For here, in order to understand this, you should have some idea about the cell cycle. Cell cycle, after the interphase, the cell enters into G1 phase, gap 1 phase, where the cell will double its content. Then after G1, it ends into S phase or synthetic phase, where this genetic materials will be doubled. DNA and proteins, they will be doubled. After synthetic phase, again the cell enters into G2 phase. That is the growth 2 phase. Again the growth, doubling of cell or cytoplasmic materials. After G2 phase, the cell enters into M phase or mitotic phase, where the cell division happens. So that's why it's very important that before every cell division, the content of the cell is to be doubled, so that when the cell enters cell division and produces two daughter cells, both the cells will get equal number of cellular contents. Suppose think that if this doesn't happen during the interphase, that is G1 phase, S phase and G2 phase. In every cell division, the cellular contents will be reduced to half. So that should not happen. Cellular, same amount of cellular components should be continued or inherited even in the daughter cells. So that's why you can say that the chromosome also which enters the cell division will have double in its construction. That is the duplicated molecules of DNA as well as proteins. And in the cell metaphase, a chromosome consists of two cylindrical units. It consists of two cylindrical units. And these cylindrical units are known as chromatids. There are two cylindrical units like this, you must have seen. It is like two cylindrical units, and they are called as chromatids. This both the chromatids are the product of replication, multiplication, or doubling from the single chromatid. First, there will be single chromatid. During the synthetic phase of the cell cycle or S phase, everything doubles, so as a result, it has two cylindrical units. Both the cylindrical units, what you call chromatids, they are identical. They are identical, hence they are known as sister chromatids. It's not wrong if I say both the chromatids are identical. That's why they are known as sister chromatids. And both of them are the result of the multiplication or replication of a single chromatid. And these two chromatids are not separate, but they are held together. They are held together at a point what is known as centromere. See, this is a, there are two chromatids. It's one single chromosome if you see in the photograph. It has two chromatids, this and this, that is known as sister chromatids. And both of them are held together at a point that is known as centromere. Centromere is the junction or the location on the chromosome where both the sister chromatids are held together. These two chromatids, these are identical chromatids, so that's why they are called as sister chromatids, and they are held together at a point what is known as centromere. Now let's try to understand about the centromere. Probably in order to understand the chromosome, knowledge on this centromere is more vital. So this centromere, where two sister chromatids are held, it is also called as primary constriction. A constriction is seen. And that's the reason where two sister chromatids are held together, and that is known as the, that's why it's also called as primary constriction. The centromeres are clearly visible only with the help of microscopes. The centromere is very important not only because it is the attachment site for two sister chromatids. During the cell division, whatever the spindles are formed by the centrioles. The spindles form also attaches to this centromere. Very rarely, some chromosomes do not have centromere. And such chromosomes which are devoid of or free from the centromere, they are called as eccentric chromosomes. Suppose if the in a chromosome centromeres are not seen or not there, then such chromosomes are called as eccentric chromosomes. So in the eccentric chromosome which do not have a centromere, the spindle fibers cannot attach there. When there is no spindle fiber, after the cell division, both the nucleus are not formed at all. Now, centromere is a region of DNA on the chromosome. It's also a region or location of DNA on the centrosome, chromosome. Especially during the cell division, a large protein structure attaches to this centromere. This protein structure which attaches to centromere is known as kinetochore. Kinetochore is nothing but the large protein structures which are being attached to the centromere only during the cell division. Even the spindle proteins or spindle fibers then get attached to this kinetochore, not directly to the centromere, but they get attached to the centromere through this kinetochore. That means they attach to the kinetochores. if you study the centromere, the centromere is made up of ...170 base pairs. The nucleotide base pairs, I am talking. Adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine. It is about 170 base pair in humans. And this centromere region also contains large number of repeated DNA sequences. Same region contains large number of repeated sequence of DNA. And this repeated sequence of DNA, they are transposable elements. See, this is the chromosome, this is the centromere where the sister chromatids join, and this centromere is very, very essential for the chromosomal segregation during the mitosis or cell division. Very essential. It consists of generally 172. But some variation will be there. So that's why we can say that it has hundreds of kilobases of repetitive segments of DNA. Hundreds of kilobases of repetitive segments of DNA. This repetitive DNA segments, in some chromosome they are not specific, but in some chromosome this repetitive DNA molecules are specific. A chromosome, because of this centromere, has two arms. The arm one above the centromere and the one which is below the centromere. Naturally, in a chromosome, one arm may be short and another one arm may be long. It all depends on the position of the centromere. I will come to that later. The tip of the chromosomes are called as telomeres. The telomere contains DNA and a protein cap. This is very, very important, the protein cap. If the protein cap is not there, the end of the DNA, sorry, end of the chromosome will be very sticky in nature. Highly sticky in nature. As a result, what will happen? It may attach with other chromosome. This chromosome may attach with the other chromosome because of the sticky nature. But thanks to protein cap on both the telomeres, this also telomere, this also telomere. If you observe the chromosome very carefully, you can see two types of bands. One is the light bands, and naturally if there is one light band, the other band will be dark band. The light bands, they replicate early in the synthetic phase, and they contain active genes. And like the light bands, there are also some dark bands. Here, the replication is very late. And it is made up of, contains condensed chromatin, which is AT rich, adenine thymine rich. The chromosomes may differ in the position of the centromere. Though it is called a centromere, it may not be in the center. So, based on the position of the centromere, the chromosomes are classified or named based on the position. In general, I can say if the centromere is near the middle, making the chromosome into two halves or two arms or equal size, then it is called as metacentric chromosome. If the centromere is towards one end, as a result, one short arm and one long arms are formed. Such chromosomes are called as acrocentric, or they are also called as submetacentric. Suppose if centromere is very near the end of the chromosome, almost at the tip, tip is known as telomere, almost at the tip of the chromosome, the chromosome is said to be telocentric. See, metacentric, it is almost in the center. As a result, it divides the chromosome into two halves of equal size. Whereas in the other one, the submetacentric, the centromere is not in the center. It is moved towards the anterior or posterior end. This, as a result, there will be one short arm and other long arm. This type of chromosomes are called as submetacentric. Whereas, if the centromere is at the tip, near the tip, it is called as acrocentric. One very short arm and another very long arm is there. Very short arm and one long arm. Suppose, if the chromosomes ends, the chromosomal end, if they join, that is at the region of the telomere. In a chromatid, two telomeres may join like this. Then it is called as telocentric chromosome. So what can you see is, the centromere divides the chromosome into two arms. In these two arms, metacentric chromosome is in the center and divides the chromosome into two components where both the arms are of equal length. Then, while the acrocentric chromosome, which has only one short and one long arm, one short arm and another long arm. in the house mouse, the chromosomes are telocentric. They are attached like this. They are attached at the tip. If you look into the human chromosomes, we have two types of chromosomes. One is metacentric and another one is acrocentric. But there is no telocentric chromosome in the human being. See, short arm is called as P arm and the long arm is called as Q arm. If the centromeres are proximal to the centromere, in the center, that means it's a centromere which is located almost in the middle. If you have a chromosome, you can and observe and you can divide that at major bands, what you call P1, P2, P3, etc. Even each such division can be further divided into lesser bands, P11, P12, like that. The centromeres, as I have already narrated, is the region where two sister chromatids of a chromosome appear to be joined. Or the most appropriate term would be held together. And that is visible clearly only during the mitotic metaphase. The centromeres are popularly called as primary construction. What's important here is to understand, during the mitosis, centromere that is shared by the sister chromatids will also divide so that chromatids can migrate to opposite poles in the cell. By tearing the chromosome, by dividing the chromosome, the sister chromatids move to opposite poles. On the other hand, we have also made one more observation. During the first meiotic division, meiosis one, the centromere of sister chromatids, they should remain intact because the splitting up of the sister chromatids in meiosis takes place in meiosis two, not in meiosis one. So they will separate at the centromere level during the meiosis two. Probably because of this reason, we can say that centromere is an important component of the chromosome structure and segregation. Even the naming of the chromosome, as we have seen, depends upon the position of the centromere. So for the day, I will stop here because if I take up the further continuation, I will not be able to understand. I will not be able to teach and you will not be able to understand. And we will meet in the next class. Okay? Any doubt?